evolution. And we've been taught that evolution is how we got here, therefore, because it's assumed that it's a scientific fact, therefore, God does not exist. So let's look at the theory for a moment. We start with nothing, there's an explosion, and that produces everything over billions and billions of years. The birds and the trees, the flowers, the moon, the sun, the stars, elephants, human beings, everything we've got. And this happens by random chance, natural selection over billions of years. Now, Charles Darwin said that in order for his theory to be true, there must be millions of in-between stages, transitional forms in the fossil record. And that if within 100 years we don't find those transitional forms, that his theory should be discarded. Well, more than 100 years has gone by, and those missing links, those transitional forms, those in-between stages, are still missing. They thought they found some of them. One of them was back in 1999. If you do the research, you'll find that a Chinese farmer glued together the head of a bird and parts of a reptile and completely fooled the worldwide scientific community, including National Geographic, with what they thought was a transitional form. It was called Archaeoraptor. Smithsonian Institution actually accused National Geographic of engaging in sensationalistic tabloid journalism. It was a hoax. Now, there is something called microevolution. This is very different. Microevolution is adaptation within a species. Look at dogs. You've got the tiny Chihuahua and the Great Dane. They're very different, but they're both dogs. Or horses. You've got zebras and donkeys. You've got the dwarf pony and the draft horse. Very different, but they're horses. Horses produce horses and dogs produce dogs. Adaptation within a species is totally different than man evolving from an entirely different species. Science has never found a genuine transitional form that is one kind of animal crossing over into another kind, either living or in the fossil record. And there's supposed to be billions of them. Now, what I'm about to show you does not exist. These were actually created by our graphic artists, but I want you to keep your eye out for this, because this is what evolutionists have been searching for hundreds of years. All right, and if you find one of these, you could become rich and famous. So here's some transitional forms. This is called the crocodile. Can you see this?
God, what a nut.
Crocodile and a duck. All right, let's try another one. This is the bullfrog. Half bull, half frog. Or, of course, the sheepdog. You're laughing, of course. Now, some of you might be saying, wait a minute, look at the platypus. There is a mammal with hair and a bill like a duck. Well, yeah, it's a strange one, and that's exactly how God made it. And there's plenty of strange animals like that. Nature is observable proof that every animal brings forth after its own kind. No one has ever seen a horse produce a non-horse, or a bird produce anything but another bird. Even the famous fossil Archaeopteryx, said to be a reptile transitioning into a bird, if you do the research, you'll find out it has been shown to be fully bird, a perching bird. It has feathers. We even have a website. It's called intelligentdesignversusevolution.com. It offers $10,000 to anyone who can present a genuine living transitional form. Charles Darwin said, quote, "I often a cold shudder has run through me as I've asked myself whether I may not have devoted myself to a fantasy." Time magazine. Scientists concede that their most cherished theories are based on embarrassingly few fossil fragments and that huge gaps exist in the fossil record. Newsweek. The more scientists have searched for the transitional forms that lie between species, the more they've been frustrated. And scientist Ernest Chain, Nobel Prize winner for developing penicillin, said, quote, "I would rather believe in fairy tales than in such wild speculation." Nature is proof, observable proof, that God made us to produce after our own kind. Man did not evolve from amoebas.
Correct.
As far as I understand, any fossil that you find at your museum is a fully formed creature. There is not something in there that is halfway between one animal and halfway between another animal that you can observe to be so. Your assumption is that evolution is true from the outset. That's your presupposition, and therefore you say that you and I are transitional forms. We're constantly changing into the next thing. That's based on your presupposition that evolution is true. But the observable evidence is that you've got animals that are fully formed. You've got adaptation within a species, but you've never seen any animal produce anything other than
because that's that not how evolution works.
You say, that's well, not I have how faith evolution that over second. Time it'll turn into something else, but you've never seen it happen. No one's ever seen it happen. And that is called macroevolution. You cannot extrapolate microevolution over time and equal macroevolution. No one's ever seen it demonstrated. I already did respond to that just prior to what she said. There was something else that I'd love to bring up before
Please do.
We... Yeah, I'd like to bring something else up. Imagine you're walking down the beach and you see in the sand some ripples in the sand, and you conclude, you know, that's really interesting. I bet that the water and the wind made those ripples in the sand. But if you keep walking and you find in the sand etched, John loves Mary forever with a heart around it and an arrow through it, you would conclude somebody must have written that. Why? Because it contains information. Nature can produce patterns. That happens all the time. But it cannot produce detailed, meaningful information. Now, you and I have something inside of our bodies called DNA. You have 10 trillion cells, and in those cells is DNA. DNA are microscopic strands containing digital information. If you connected all of your DNA strands together, they'd reach from the Earth to the sun and back 66 times in your body and in mine. And that whole thing is packed with genetic encoded digital information that is the instructions on how to make a nose, eyes, ears, teeth, skin, hair, bones, lungs, a heart, a stomach. How did the information get in there? By accident? Charles Darwin spoke of the simple cell, but that was so long ago, he didn't have the level of knowledge that we have now and couldn't see down to the DNA level where you have the enormous complexity and the very specific information. Remember, nature produces patterns, but not information. And if you do the research, you will find that any self-respecting molecular biologist would tell you no one has a clue how the human body could possibly build itself by an accidental process. You say, well, then why do so many people believe it? I'm hoping to answer that question for you tonight, at least from my perspective as a former atheist myself, if we have time.
Hey, what's going on, brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ? I'm sharing you this clip that I watched a while ago, but it was so powerful that it still rocks me to this day. How Kirk Cameron and Ray Comfort really went at these two atheists. I love the points that he made right here. If you want to watch the whole debate, I left the link below. Also, Ray Comfort made a movie called The Atheist Delusion. I strongly encourage you, if you have not watch it, please. And yeah, God bless you guys. Thank you so much for taking time to watch this. Be hidden in Christ. God bless.
I once was lost in darkest night, yet thought I knew the way. The sin that promised joy and life had led me to